up above the battleground, the only place where peace is found. Nothing to fight, to win or lose. And the gunfire fades out, and the cries for love grow loud up above.
So let's just join with Holy Spirit for a few moments. And Holy Spirit, whenever we find ourselves in the midst of the battle, on the battleground, help us with your love and your peace to see differently, to rise above. Open our eyes and only see the light and the love of God, and that we are all one. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Amen. So, today's Super Bowl Sunday.
Yay.
For some of us. Right? So today, it's kind of why I got rising above the battleground, you know, Super Bowl Sunday, fighting against the battle. So we're going to talk a little bit about gladiators. We're going to talk about the war against ourselves. Talk about the sword of Damocles. Talk about lowering our shields. And of course, above the battleground. And then we'll do a meditation at the end. I will be still an instant and go home. And really, we should probably just move right to the meditation, right? We don't have to talk about the battleground. We already know what the battleground is like, right? So when I was thinking about this whole thing, this idea of the battleground, and you know, the Super Bowl was coming up, and I came across an article somebody had written, this idea of that comparing gladiators with NFL players. And so they both perform in stadiums, right? With the cheering and the jeering, both. They're risking physical injury. And if they're successful, they're a hero or a god, right? And if not, well, they're losers, right? So, of course, the major difference is that our professional football players get paid. We're gladiators, we're slaves. That's how it was. And they dedicate their lives to this. Of course, NFL players aren't forced to fight to the death as gladiators were. So, in reference to like Spartacus, you know, I know there's a TV series and, of course, movies about Spartacus and everything. And the theme there is the myth of glory that goes with the, to keep the slaves willingly in line. And the gladiators buy into this whole system, this whole thought system of the glory of combat. I'm going to do it. I'm going to beat the other guy. And then they're also taught they'll achieve immortality if they win. They're appealing to the crowds. They'll become gods. And so that's the price that they pay. They don't really see that they're just toys in a game for the Romans' enjoyment. So, and the gladiators, they just go ahead. They, you know, they drink the Kool-Aid. They go ahead and they go ahead with it. They accept this reality because they have despair, because their life otherwise has no meaning whatsoever. It doesn't matter that their comrades have died in vain in this whole process. And so then we have the NFL players. Whatever team you're on today, it's okay. They're not quite as high for the NFL players. They're not going to be stuck with swords or spits or anything like that. But we want to be entertained. We demand blood to be spilled if necessary. So what happens if the quarterback hurts his knee in the game? Can't put weight on it to throw the ball. He comes out of the game. And what's his sin? He doesn't look like there's something wrong with him. Right? He's just sitting on the sidelines and we're not seeing anything. He looks okay to me. We want proof of his injury. They question his manhood. But if he would have gone in there, took it like a man, limped his way in there, even if it meant playing horribly and losing the game, even that, then he would be a hero because he played injured. Never mind it later on, these guys with all the concussions and everything else that they had, you know, has destroyed some people's lives. But going back to Spartacus, he saw another way, right? There must be another way of looking at this. He saw the truth and he rebelled. Now, I don't know if all the NFL players are going to rebel in this, but what have we bought into? What's the glory of this world that we've bought into? You know, oh, I can make it work. No matter if my mind is crippled with what's going on, I can make this work. But what do? We get caught up in it. Get caught up in the glory of the game, the ego game that we're playing. So it's the ego's thought system. And we think it's holy in a way, right? It's powerful. I've got power. Yet, we have to protect ourselves at every moment. We don't know what the other guy's going to do. We've got to protect ourselves. We don't know what God's going to do to us, right? Separation. Got to keep our defenses up. And so with the other guys, with ourselves, God, whatever, got to keep the armor on. Shoulder pads or whatever armor, you know, in our mind, the armor, the judgments, whatever it may be. And so we operate from the belief that we must protect ourselves from what is happening because it is threatening us. So whatever's happening in a situation, a relationship, I gotta protect myself. There's a threat there. I'm being attacked. Gotta defend myself. And why does the defense happen? It stems from fear. Right? Get into a phone call with somebody. Right away, it feels like they're attacking as soon as you get on the phone. Defenses go up. There's a battle raging. But do I have to get engaged in the battle? But it's just a dream. It's a dream that we've made up. Serving the Lord of Death in that. As it says in text 29:5, section 5, those who serve the Lord of Death have come to worship in a separated world, each with his tiny spear and rusted sword to keep his ancient promises to die. We hang on to it. So we have against the other person, against God, and we got it against ourselves, the war against ourselves. How strange is this war against ourselves? We all do it all the time. Judgments. You know, you make a mistake. The judgments come in. Why did you do that? Why did you say that? Should have said something else, but you didn't. What do? Beat ourselves up over it. So we believe that everything is a sin. And it can hurt us and become the enemy. Even ourselves, or enemies against ourselves. And we attack ourselves with the tiny spear and the rusted sword. Over and over again. That's what we want. Well, what does Jesus tell us here in 23, in the introduction, text 23? Walk you in glory with your head held high and fear no evil. The innocent are safe because they share their innocence. Nothing they see is harmful. For their awareness of the truth releases everything from the illusion of harmfulness. And what seemed harmful now stands shining in their innocence, released from sin and fear, and happily returned to love. They share the strength of love because they looked on innocence. We've forgiven. We've joined with the Holy Spirit. Not to butt heads, but to join together. And so when we do that, come across that bridge. This is from the workbook 134. As powerful as love, which laid its blessing on it, are all dreams of evil and of hatred and attack brought silently to truth, when I can just take that moment to forgive and join with the Holy Spirit. He tells us he does not have to fight to save himself. We don't have to fight to save ourselves anymore. We're already saved. He does not have to kill the dragons, which he thought pursued him. Nor need he erect the heavy walls of stone and iron doors he thought would make him safe. He can remove the ponderous and useless armor made to chain his mind to fear and misery. His step is light and he lifts his foot to stride ahead. A star is left behind to point the way to those who follow him. I didn't remember that it talked about dragons in the course. When I was looking up some of these ideas of the sword and battleground attack, that sort of thing, it surprised me. I mean, we know we erect the walls, right? Between our brother, between God, between ourselves, the truth of who we are. We do that. So it's taking that moment to thinking, what are the walls that I've put up? What are those walls? Think about that for a moment. What are the walls that I have put up? Perhaps it's a wall of blame. You know, as I was doing some reflection on this, you know, putting this together for today, I realized I wasn't so much angry at the other person that I was blaming. I was angry at myself for continually believing and trusting the person. So I wasn't really angry out there. I was angry in here at me. So what I put up, a wall up there, it's like, oh no, I gotta look at this. And then it's been this constant, Holy Spirit, help me with this. I don't want to accept the blame. I don't want to accept the responsibility. I don't want that big word, responsibility, because then what? I gotta do something about it. It's easier for me to just say it's his fault and I will engage in battle with he, she, it, organization, whatever it may be. Is that what I'm going to do? Put on my armor. But he's saying we don't need to do that anymore. We don't need to put the heavy walls up or the iron doors or put on the armor that's kept us chained to the fear and misery. He says forgiveness must be practiced, for the world cannot perceive its meaning nor provide a guide to teach you its beneficence. The ego is not going to teach us about peace and about who we truly are. When we practice forgiveness, there we would meet with our reality in freedom and in peace, is what he continues to go on to say. So with this war against ourselves, you probably remember the story of Sword of Damocles? A little bit. So the Sword of Damocles is a story used to describe a sense of foreboding and might translate what it's saying here into English idiom as walk a mile in my shoes. I'm going to use it in a slightly different way, but I'll let you know what the story was about. And so Dionysus II was a 4th century tyrant of Syracuse in the Greek area of southern Italy. He was rich. He was comfortable. He had slaves. He had whatever he wanted. It was his, all power, everything. So one of these slaves was Damocles. And he made comments to the king all the time. Wow, you just like live so coolly, man. You got all this money, you got the chicks, you got the fame, you got it all. Man, I'm so jealous of this. I said, okay. If you think you're so lucky, if you think I'm so lucky, how about you try out my life? So, dress him in the royal robes, you know, got his crib. He got the chicks, he got the fame, he got the money, everything. Then one moment he looks up. There's a sword hanging above his head by just a horse hair. Just hanging there. It's like, whoa, what's this? And he said to, you know, Dionysus, well, what's this? And he said, well, this is what it's really like to be a ruler. Yeah, you got it all, but you never know when it's going to end. Just a horsehair. And so Damocles said, no, thank you. I'll go back to being where I was. I don't need it anywhere. I don't need it anymore. I like the safer life, which was being poor and doing that. So what is the sword of Damocles hanging over our own head that we think, hey, if we got this, if we got that, it's going to make my life better. But it's hanging there. Maybe something we haven't forgiven. That judgment, whatever it may be. Now we think, wow, if I fix my world the way I want it, everything's going to be okay. But if I don't fix my mind, that's the sword hanging above my head. I remember one time years ago with my ex-husband. He's the one that had molested my two older daughters. And for quite some time, you know, I didn't even think about it, but one day it came to mind. I was like, I've been holding him hostage for what he did. I mean, we could certainly say, okay, yeah, but it was right and righteous to do all this and everything. But if we're looking from the course perspective, is it really that righteous to do? And I realized I've been holding the sword above his head. Then I had the insight, who am I really holding the sword above? It's me. You know, this idea of that, you know, the course talks about the idea of the, you know, the prisoner and the guard. Guess who's linked to the prisoner? The jailer. Why? Because I got to make sure you ain't getting out 24/7. So where is the freedom in that? Because I punish? But when I forgive, I'm released. Now, does that mean I forget what happened? Do I let it happen again? That sort of thing? No. I'm going to be smart in what I do, because there's things here in the world that we may still need to do. But in my mind, I can forgive and let go. So in the section above the battleground, which is 23:4 in the text, in God there is no attack. And no illusion in any form stalks heaven. And he's asking us to see it differently, to see our brother differently, to see ourselves differently. And he talks about the idea of murder. Murder and love are incompatible. And have you ever had those murderous thoughts, somebody who did you wrong? It's okay to admit it. You know, I'm going to get even with them. I'm going to get them. I wish they would just die. Come on, be honest, yes. We did it. We've all done it at one time or another. It happens. You know, it's to be honest with my mind where I've been. But it's incompatible with love, is what he's saying here. And who am I really murdering? Right? I'm murdering myself, back to myself. So God doesn't share the function of the body. That doesn't exist at all. Life makes not death, creating like itself. So now he tells us, this is a wonderful paragraph, it's paragraph 4. The lovely light of your relationship is like the love of God. It cannot yet assume the holy function God gave his son, for your forgiveness of your brother is not complete as yet. And so it cannot be extended to all creation. Each form of murder and attack that still attracts you and that you do not recognize for what it is, limits the healing and the miracles you have the power to extend to all. So when I'm still hanging on to those thoughts, those attack thoughts, grievances are hiding the light, miracles. Yet the Holy Spirit understands how to increase your little gifts and make them mighty. So just having that little bit of willingness to see it all differently, Holy Spirit can work wonders with it. He also understands how your relationship can be raised above the battleground in it no more. And this is your part to realize that murder in any form, attack, judgment, etc., is not our will. The overlooking of the battleground is now the purpose that we have. So be lifted up from a higher place and look down upon it. If anybody has seen like the Lord of the Rings, the movies, you see the epic battles, you know, taking place. But if you're that bird flying above, you don't see the lines, you know, wars in our world. Do we see lines in the ground of this country is here and this country is here? Even our states, do we see that? No, there are no lines. There is no need to battle. And so we lift up upon it. Do we want to have murder as our choice, in whatever way, form that is, while we're here in the world? Whatever that person said or did, that organization, that governor, whatever. Do we want that? So how can a battle be perceived as nothingness when you engage in it? How can the truth of miracles be recognized if murder is your choice? When the temptation to attack rises to make your mind darkened and murderous, remember you can see the battle from above. Even in forms you do not recognize, the signs you know. So it's tuning into ourselves. There's a stab of pain, he says. A twinge of guilt. And above all, probably know this one, a loss of peace. That's a big clue that we're engaged in battle. And he says, this you know well. He knows us. He knows that we get engaged in the battle. When they occur, leave not your place on high, but quickly choose a miracle instead of murder. And God himself and all the lights of heaven will gently lean to you and hold you up, raise us up. For you have chosen to remain where he would have you. And no illusion can attack the peace of God together with his son. So we rise above. And he says, see no one from the battleground. For there you look on him from nowhere. For only bodies could attack and murder. And if this is your purpose, then you must be one with them. But the body has a purpose. So I want to unite in the truth. The love. So it's having that willingness. It's joining with Holy Spirit. Well, before the willingness, why? I'm aware, right? I'm aware of what's going on within me. Then I'm having the willingness. I'm joining with Holy Spirit. I'm rising above. Only the light they love is in awareness, and only love shines upon them forever. Then he still says, perhaps you think the battleground can offer you something you can win. I'm going to win. With this person, I'm going to win. Battle of wits. Can it be anything that offers you a perfect calmness? Engaged in the battle. Those with the strength of God and their awareness could never think of battle. So it's not to beat ourselves up again if we're engaged in the battle. It's okay, I see I'm engaged in the battle. You know, even if it's in the middle of a phone call, okay, I see I'm engaged in the battle. Not too long ago, I was engaged in the battle on the phone with somebody, and I said to the other person, I need to stop. I need to stop right here, right then, and stop. I don't even know how long I stopped for. I just knew I didn't want to be in the battle anymore. I knew I wanted to rise above. And I really didn't care what the other person's response was, because for me, peace was my one goal. That was the most important thing for me. And so stopping in the middle of the phone call and saying, I need to stop, was important to me. So we can step away from the battle anytime. if we really say, what is my priority? What is my purpose? For me, it's always peace is the one goal. So I may not always do it that way, but for me, it was like, yes, I can do it. I can stop in the middle of a phone call. Because usually what, it's afterwards, after you've been on the phone with somebody or after you've had an argument with somebody, then you decide, okay, I was wrong, I need to choose peace. Da, da, da. But if we can do it in the moment that it's happening, or even before it happens, that's a real gift that we give to ourselves. So the senselessness of conquest is quite apparent from the quiet sphere above the battleground. And so with God, how can we not succeed? How could we not win? So that's what we do. We rise above to see the love that really is there, to see our brothers, to see God, see ourselves with the oneness and the love that we are. Because all we really want is peace. If we're engaged in a battle, we just want peace. We want it to stop. I know I do. It's like, I just wish it would stop. I just want peace. So I can if I stop an instant and go home in my mind to God. So that's what we're going to do now. We're going to do a meditation. And I'm going to use pieces of Lesson 182, which is, I will be still an instant and go home. So just take a few moments to take a deep breath. Just focus on that breath. Simply relaxing. Choosing peace instead of everything that's gone before. With each breath, just allow yourself to relax a little more deeply, a little more peacefully. Because peace is what you really want. So take another breath and just allow yourself to relax even more. Even allowing the music to help soothe you on the way. Somewhere in your mind, you know that this world that you seem to live in is not really home to you. Somehow you know that it's true. Deep within your mind, a memory of home keeps calling you. It's a place that wants you to return to. Though you may not recognize the voice, nor what the voice reminds you of, yet it's calling you. Somehow you've felt an alien here in the world, from somewhere all unknown. Nothing definite that you could say with certainty that you're in exile here, but there's been this persistent feeling, sometimes not more than a tiny throb, other times hardly remembered, actively dismissed. It returns to your mind again. This is not my real home. In some way, somehow, everyone has this feeling that they are not where they need to be. And sometimes we go upon an endless search, seeking in darkness what we cannot find, not even recognizing what it is that we seek. Thousand homes we make, yet none contents our restless mind. There's no substitute for heaven. All we ever made here was hell. Talking about our childhood home. This is home with our father. It's our father's holiness that lights up heaven. And this child within you knows his father. He desires to go home so deeply, so unceasingly. His voice cries unto you to let him rest a while. This child within you just wants to breathe again the holy air that fills his father's home. It needs to rest in silence and in peace and love. And he will go home and you along with him. Very simply, when you're still an instant, when the world recedes from you, when valueless ideas cease to have value in your restless mind, then you will hear his voice. He calls to you until you can resist him no longer. In that instant, he will take you to his home, and you will stay with him in perfect stillness, silent, and at peace beyond all words, untouched by fear and doubt, sublimely certain that you are at home. So take time to lay aside your shield, which profits nothing. Lay down the spear and the sword you raised against an enemy without existence. Christ has called you friend and brother. He's even come to ask your help in going home today. So just take some time now just to be with it. be with these feelings. This peace. Your thought. So at this time, you're seeing what your heart's desire is, a desire for your innocence that never was lost. The call is always there. The Holy Child remains with you. His home is yours. Today, he gives you his defenselessness, and you accept it in exchange for all the toys of battle you have made. And now the way is open. And the journey has an end in sight at last. So we take away from this today to just be still an instant. And go home with him and be at peace a while. And within your mind, just offer gratitude to the Holy Spirit for whatever insights or gifts you receive today. As you're ready, you can start to wiggle your fingers and toes and open your eyes as you're ready. Coming back with peace and the remembrance of home.